Whose attention do you desire? And whose approval do you crave? The attitude of the modest woman. Adornment and dress is an area with which women are often concerned and in which there are dangers of immodesty or indiscretion. And so, motivated by a genuine concern for the women of this church, I will attempt to address this topic this morning. Ladies, I would only ask this morning that you work hard applying this message to your own heart and life. Please do not assume that you are sufficiently mature in heart or modest in dress. And please avoid the temptation to busy yourselves applying this message to someone else seated nearby. Any biblical discussion of modesty begins by addressing the heart, not the hemline. And the emphasis upon the heart is undeniably present in this passage. Let me draw your attention to verse 9, and let me draw your attention to the phrase, with modesty and self-control. The women should adorn themselves in respectable apparel. That would be her appearance. And her attitude is emphasized, her motive is emphasized in the following, with modesty and self-control. All respectable apparel is the fruit of a godly heart. Ladies, your wardrobe is a public statement of your personal and private motivation. And if you profess godliness, your motivation is to be distinct from our culture as it relates to appearance and dress and fashion. It is to be motivated by modesty and self-control. Listen, immodesty is much more than wearing a low-cut skirt or dress. Immodesty is an expression of arrogance. Immodesty reveals the absence of humility. Immodesty is the act of drawing undue attention to yourself. A modest heart always precedes modest dress. Modesty is humility expressed in dress. Modesty is humility expressed in dress. A desire to serve others, particularly men, and not promote or provoke sensuality or lust. Modesty, self-control. Modesty and self-control are distinctly present in the godly woman, and they make a distinct difference in her dress and in her wardrobe. John MacArthur has written, "How does a woman discern the sometimes fine line between proper dress and dressing to be the center of attention?" The answer, he writes, starts in the intent of the heart. That is exactly right, which is where Paul starts here. The answer starts in the intent of the heart. A woman should examine her motives and goals for the way she dresses. Is her intent to show the grace and beauty of womanhood? Is it to reveal a humble heart devoted to worshiping God? Or is it to call attention to herself and flaunt her beauty. Or worse, to attempt to allure men sexually. A woman who focuses on worshiping God will consider carefully how she is dressed, because her heart will dictate her wardrobe and appearance. You must ask yourself, is your appearance and dress consistent with biblical values of modesty and self-control and respectable apparel? Or does your hairstyle, does your dress reveal an inordinate identification and fascination with sinful cultural values? Ladies, who inspires your dress? Who, through your dress, are you identifying with? Are your role models the godly women of Scripture or the worldly women of our culture? Are your role models Esther, Deborah, Sarah, or are your role models Britney Spears and Halle Berry? Ladies, your dress is not to be an identification or association with this sinful culture. It is not to be a distraction to the church gathered. And it is not to draw undue attention to you. Young ladies in particular can be ignorant of the war with lust men daily confront. Young ladies in particular simply don't have a clue about what is actually going on in the mind of a man, young or old. They are often ignorant of the effect of their bodies on the eyes and the hearts of men. They are often ignorant that men are visually stimulated. After this message, no lady here can claim ignorance. Listen carefully now. Listen to the next statement. I also want this to be a church where the unconverted can come dressed immodestly and be warmly welcomed and not self-righteously judged. I want this to be a church where women, godly women, motivated by grace, dress modestly. And I want this to be a church where the unconverted or immature can come dressed immodestly and be warmly welcomed. Let this be a church populated by the unconverted dressing immodestly and warmly welcomed into our midst. I also want this to be a church where the newly converted, the immature, and even the mature, if immodestly dressed, would be cared for through gracious correction. The newly converted, the immature, and the mature, if immodestly dressed, would be cared for and graciously corrected. Modesty is the responsibility of the entire church. Again, corrected not by self-righteous individuals, but by those who consider themselves the worst sinner they know, but corrected nonetheless. You know what I hope one of the effects of this message is? I hope that humble individuals who truly care will be free from the fear of woman and approach other ladies not with condemnation or a conclusion, but with an observation either about wardrobe in general or a particular piece of clothing specifically. I will be disappointed if that isn't the fruit or effect of this message. What is to be noticeable about a woman professing godliness is not her wardrobe, but her good works. There is to be this observable lifestyle of serving others. That's the appropriate adornment. That's the godly adornment for women who profess to be Christians. That is, in effect, the transforming effect of the gospel. The transforming effect of the gospel is less time in the bathroom, less time at the mall, and more time serving family and church. And so, ladies, which are you more preoccupied with? Shopping or good works? What are you noticed for? Clothes or good works? What are you known for? Fashion or good works? What is most eye-catching about you? Your clothing or your character? And mothers, what is your daughter learning from you? For she is surely studying you. Is she learning the latest fashion? Paul isn't simply advocating modesty in dress. He's insisting that more time be devoted, more energy be devoted to spiritual adornment in the form of good works. And he is warning about excessive attention devoted to appearance, to the neglect of good works. I am concerned. You should be concerned about modest dress because of the gospel. That's why Paul's concerned. That's why I'm concerned. That's why you should be concerned. You see, we cannot isolate verse 8 from the first 7 verses of this chapter. A transition takes place in verse 8. Verse 8 proceeds with the assumption that one has read and understood verses 1 through 7 of 1 Timothy chapter 2. So Paul writes there, in effect, therefore, or I desire then, as a result of previous verses. Likewise, as he addresses the women, you cannot divorce verse 8 from verses 1 through 7. And verses 1 through 7, it is clear, it is unarguably clear that it is the gospel that motivates Paul. It is the gospel that informs Paul. It is the gospel that defines Paul. It is the gospel that leads him to express this concern beginning in verse 8 to the men, his concerns articulated in verse 9 and 10 to the women. It is the gospel. Regardless of topic, Paul teaches every topic in relation to the gospel. For Paul, all topics proceed from and are related to the gospel. Please, please, do not misinterpret, do not misunderstand, do not misapply this message. Paul is not a conservative. This is not some alternative or addition to the Book of Virtues. This isn't some general appeal for morality. This, modesty, it's about the gospel. That's what this is about. Modesty in dress, and women characterized by good works, they are the effect of the gospel. That's the transforming effect of the gospel. Modest hearts, respectable apparel, good works. And in these ways we are to be distinct. For our brothers who are saved, for the lost yet to be saved, and ultimately for the Savior who saved us. It's about the gospel. Now, here's the good news as well. The gospel provides forgiveness. So for all who have been convicted through this message, I just want to, at this moment, lead you to the foot of the cross so that you might survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died for the very sins that he has been bringing to your attention during this message, so that you might receive forgiveness, so that you might change by grace and for his glory. Let's not wait a moment longer.